blood, blue as corpses, the wave of
Norsemen. The channel is narrow, Welshmen. There is not room for two ships to pass.
Turn round then, back with you to the whales and mermaids. What men have come down from the north today, so that their names may be carved on a gravestone at the shore?
Great heroes! Fit kund sigot serk dag skop hogund fin thor evind ali hagun magnus hoped sigurd they feed the ravens they shake the sun from their shields what is the name of the land behind you
Anglesey the fair and holy island
where we will land there for her and women
We welcome you to Anglesey with arrows in the Welsh fashion.
Welcome
It will be a ragged winter in Shetland, but not as cold as for long. Archers, are you within? My tongue is tied! In a lucky time.
I greet you well also. We have had a brave reception in Wales.
Who is this young man who has fought for you with a psalter?
He is Magnus, son of Earl, son of Kelvin, son of Ragnvald, great and mighty Earls. Death is proud of such heroes in his keeping. There's a card in every battle.
A cow would not be sitting in the very teeth of the swords. The man I strayed is yours, King of Norway. A golden thunderbolt has fallen on Wales. Your queen will see you in Norway. You will show her your crown with a new and precious jewel.
A proclamation from the hand of the King of Norway to the princes and chiefs of the West. Now all the islands to the north and west of Britain are under the hand of Norway, from Faroe to Scilly, and Orkney is the chiefest earl of all these. We confer that the servant called Thomson is earl of Orkney, and that his brother, Earl Thomson, is earl of Orkney also. May they govern long in peace and favour. And we declare that after Paul and Edmund, there shall govern in Orkney Hakon, son of Paul, and Magnus, son of Edmund. These two right leal and sweet and trusty servants who fought for us in the sea battle, and men and of worthy therefore to be gathered into the one great music of the North.
another stranger that will presently appear to you, my dark opposite, the tempter. He will come in many subtle disguises, the tempter. And I am never far from one another. We are close as twins. You will suffer 5 temptations. Look where he comes.
I bring you great tidings, Magnus. You must sail on the king's ship. You are destined to be a hero and great warrior. Here is an axe for the waters. It will bring you fame and glory.
Who should rather bring me a psalter down to the ship?
The first white threads are in the loom now. Magnus, go to the war in peace.
There is a certain girl in Shetland, Ingerth, is beautiful, chaste, modest. You are to be Earl here in Orkney one day. There must be children to follow.
Magnus, the ship left Shetland with Ingerth.
Magnus, you are bidden now to the marriage.
No, but I cannot come. I have to study statecraft and the duties of a ruler, and I wish well to the ceremony and the guests.
You are summoned.
But I have no suitable clothes. See what I wear. Scorched and stained with a burning of desire.
There is a coat being woven for you. I have come here
waiting for none.
Lord Magnus, there is something I must show you, a certain worthy thing of particular interest to you. Your dear late father, Earl and Thomson, was good enough to repose in me a certain measure of trust. I standing so close to the throne in my office of Chancellor, and so I hope my God will you in time hear the look the coat of state of the earth of Orkney.
Touch it, my Lord Magnus. Is yours, it belongs to you.
Or rather, it belongs both to you and Earl Hakon. But we can hardly slice the coat in two with a sword. There are not lacking ways and means whereby, in the course of a few years, Magnus Ellenson might be solar in Orkney. On his shoulders a lord could hang the coat of a drum.
The coat belongs equally to Hakon and me.
Stronger than you. I have a home.
right for a coward to wear the long, bright, holy coat. God has made me Earl in this place. The harp is bleeding, I know it. My work is a work of peace, to bind up the wounds in the music. I must learn to harp well among the seven red beasts. Leave me.
My lord, hands were set on fire last night. Foreign horsemen have been seen. One of your ships was sunk this morning. This harp of yours, swords have smashed it to pieces already. Earl Hakon has broken through. It is war.
Give me my sword.
Wouldn't your lordship be better with a soldier? Remember the battle in Menai. We monks still laugh when we remember that.
great stories to tell. Once you are flushed with ale, and you can sing ballads in Gaelic, in English, as if having no ties of family or nation, you belong to one great brotherhood. But where it comes to business, all this is wiped from your faces. With all the hard, cruel bone underneath. Glam the farmer, he only had no flitch or bacon for these old Harkins men. Keep pigs. So you hung him from a rafter while his wife stood in the door screaming as he kicked himself to death. While Magnus murdered old at first, who had set his wife and daughter on board, sent them away. You said you wanted living, so you threw him in a bowl and stoned him dead. They put the curse of truth on you. They put on you the curse.
Dominus obiscum, I have little time for you. The hospital is full, the brothers can't take in any more wounded men. They are always occupied, bandaging, praying, putting broth into mouths. You war men have given us plenty to do. A fine slaughterhouse you've made
not invite you, we summon you. You must come.
I'm sorry. I've no skill at patching up an old coat.
Saint Olaf, in your mercy, put some light back in my eyes. A gleam in my scar. Saint Treadwell, Saint Nin, Saint Cormac, Saint Columba, Saint Treadwell.
First the blind hag!
She is what Orkney has been reduced to in the past 3 years. Old blind ragman. She's a fitting symbol. It is right that she should be here.
Saint
what we propose on Agency is perfectly straightforward. On Easter Monday, Earl Hakon and Earl Magnus will meet there for a peace conference. The heirs are to sail towards the island. One from the west and one from the north, with 8 ships each.
Not 8 ships, 2 ships.
2 or 8, what is the significance of ships? They'd be better going to a peace conference in one lobster boat.
Father the earth! It will be an important ceremony.
Here in Mercy we will pray for the dove to fall. A small splash of white among the deluges and the thunder. A branch across the beak brought, we think, from the tree of innocence and atonement. A simple blessing on the things that men oppose. Peacemaking is at best the patching of an old coat to make true peace. The Pax Christi is to weave the seamless garment.
You will not come to Eaglesay Father.
I do not think your treaty will do much good at all. Perhaps for a month it will, perhaps for 10 years, then it's back to the old mischief again.
Oh, We are not to proceed. Something frightful will happen if we land on Eaglesay today. At the very least, the negotiations with Earl Hakon will not be a success. That wave was a warning to us.
My lord, I think we should turn back. It is foolishness to ignore such an extraordinary phenomenon. A single sudden mountain of salt in a salt plain. It almost has uttered a warning. It may be that nature has a wisdom hidden from men.
And now, my good angel, whom God has appointed to be my guardian, watch over me. An untimely death might still seem good and acceptable. But what of the husbandman who is cut down by sudden sides in the middle of the glee? My mouth is ashes, dust, salt. If only we could look with the eye of an angel on the whole history of men, sub specie aeternatis, it would have the brevity and the beauty of the dance at the altar. Since all the round of time is gathered into this ritual altar dance, the actions of every man, once the bread of divine wisdom is in his body, his actions, thoughts, reverberate through the whole web of time. Men not yet born will be changed either for good or for evil by his speech and the things that his hands find to do. A man can therefore direct his purified will into the future. The pain of the dead is soothed by a healing word or thought. Perhaps the pain of all history might be touched with healing
Thank you. the errants of faction have been coming from this lonely isle all through Sunday night and this morning. There is a blackout of news.
Neither of the parties is willing to give anything away. Through interviews with crofters and fishermen and their wives, we have been able to build up a fairly definite picture.
The pulse and errands at Dedlock seemed a week ago to me as intractable as ever, with all its bloody and tragic repercussions. Tentative peace overtures have been made from time to time in the course of the past 16 months. The venue for this final scene is widely known, the island of Eggelsay, which lies in a fairly neutral position between the Policeman and Erlandson power spheres.
The fact that both leaders were to be present in Eggelsay marked a highly significant development. Policeman and Erlandson have never seen or communicated with each other for upward of 3 years.
Our correspondent has spoken to many islanders. Can you describe the scene for us, Mr. Wilson?
I was down at the beach collecting some driftwood for my fire when I saw two launches approaching from Rossi and Wyre. They weren't pleasure boats, nor fishing boats either.
At the island mission, Mr. Andrew MacPhail agreed that a man had spent the previous evening in his manse and afterwards in the church. He refused to identify the man as Magnus Erlandson.
The island was swarming with strangers, and in the first light I got a few lobsters. When I went up to phone the Fishermen's Society in Stromness, I couldn't get through. They told me the lines have been cut.
Rowing Magnus Erlandson! Come out to the
street! Way now you're in the church!
I came here in this weekend because I heard rumors speaking of it. There's like to be a crowd in every week this weekend.
The church!
The sort that likes having their fortunes told! And where there's folks, there's Perkins!
Come out and surrender!
Come out and surrender!
One man stood on the hill looking with binoculars north and east for more than an hour. I thought I recognized him from seeing his photo in the papers. Magnus Erlandson!
The situation is still confused. What is certain is that if I will not his sign somewhere today, it will be a settlement dictated by Pulse. It is known that among his party is Little, the celebrated butcher, Sheriff, and Kingdom.
Satisfaction, sir. How on earth am I going to on salmon or venison at this time of night.
Well spoken, Mr. Lifolf. It is simply a question of hanging a carcass.
Certainly, that will present no difficulty.
Mr. Lifolf, I begin to like you more and more. Like a true patriot, with promptness and the willingness to carry out orders.
My instruments are in the cookhouse. Could you please arrange for the carcass to be transferred to that part of camp?
That will not be necessary. We have suitable premises, known only to a few. You'll find the place of interest, Mr. Lifolf. It is filled with exactly the hooks of your trade in stainless steel. Mr. Lifolf, I do not think that you are aware of the nature of the task that we are asking you to do. For any true patriot, it would be a great honor. You do not require to be told we are at war. We do not fear fallen soldiers. The enemy we fear is the enemy within our borders. Here in this camp, we have a special task: to destroy the hussar! Mr. Lifolf, we proceed to light to the elimination of one another's enemies. A man is to be executed. For years he has spread his heretical opinions. He was warned over and over. He was rejected by the political police. He was given the opportunity to leave the country. We did not wish to touch him too closely. He has a certain world fame. But he would not hold his tongue. And tonight we have received instructions. We wish to show your spirit by means of the butcher's hook. That he is, after all, when all is said and done, a man is born, like other men.
Such a thing. It is not my nature. I am a chef, not an executioner. I do not know the man, and it is inconceivable that I should do such a thing to another human being.
Mr. Lifolf, a decision has been made. And we will proceed to the execution at once. Everything has been prepared, Mr. Lethal. The prisoner will stand against you. Your duty will be simply to put the noose around his throat. I will raise my hand. That will be the sign. We'll then pull the spool away. It is simple.
Thank you.
yes, yes, yes.